Hey, I am going to try this again. I recorded this entire unit, and it said it was working, it said it did it, and I went to review it, and it only recorded 6 minutes, and I don't know where the rest was. So I decided, because it was 40-something slides, it's the same unit, I just split it in two parts to break up the recording. So your first part here, yes, this is everything that's included. It's chapter 43 to 52. It's just going to be split into two different recordings, but it's one whole lecture on the entire unit cover for the test. So just focus on what I tell you. If I tell you to skip it, I don't mention it, you don't need to know it. Okay, so I'm going to take your blood pressure, so try to relax and not think about what a high reading might mean for your change chances of living a long, healthy life. I thought this was just funny. Okay, a good way to start. No, I don't need you to memorize this. It's just talking about the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. So each drug that we will talk about, each class, works in a different place. So your ARBs, your ACE inhibitors, angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, ACE inhibitors, work to prevent the angiotensin 1 to change to angiotensin 2, which is a real strong vasoconstrictor. That place where that conversion takes place is in the lungs, why your ACE inhibitors tend to have a big problem with a cough. Your ARBs, angiotensin receptor blockers, actually block this they don't block the conversion to angiotensin 2, but they block the angiotensin 2 from attaching and converting in your aldosterone. So those ARBs, angiotensin receptor blockers, block right in here. Then you have your ones that block your renin aldosterone conversion, and you have ones that block your excretion, and blocking that vasoconstriction and leading to, if it's not blocked, you have your release of antidiuretic hormone and aldosterone. So you have things that block in this section. That's all I'm going to tell you here. You don't have to read that whole section. So antihypertensives, chapter 43. We are going to begin on page 728. Actually, further, if you go to page 731, look at your table 43.1, your ACE inhibitors. There's a million of them. What do you notice in all of them? They all end in pril. ACE inhibitors, prils. So focus on your benazepril, but all of them end in pril. They're oral tablets. They're all for adults only. This next slide gives you a picture of your renin, which is released from your kidneys to do this conversion, and this is where it blocks. It blocks your angiotensin 1 from converting into angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 is a vasoconstrictor, constricting those vessels. So all your prils will block that conversion. This is a real good picture, even though I said benazepril. It doesn't matter which pril you're looking at. A good picture: when I'm on board, I control hypertension by decreasing peripheral arterial resistance. It decreases it because it blocks that vasoconstriction. And ACE inhibitors may cause first dose syncope. Your ACE inhibitors and your ARBs, angiotensin retention receptor blockers, both have this first dose possible syncope or excessive hypotension. As with most ACE inhibitors, watch for dizziness, hypotension, nausea, vomiting, and cough. Cough is a biggie. I thought this was a great little thing I found that I put here. Side effects of ACE inhibitors: they use the initials captopril, which is one of many of the ACE inhibitors. Cough, because they get this nagging, tickly cough, and they end up having to come off the ACE inhibitor. It's because of where that conversion is taking place in the lungs. Angioedema, more common in the African-American population, is swelling in the mouth and the tongue. Proteinuria, protein in the urine, because even though at low doses, ACE inhibitors can actually be a little protective of the kidneys, it can also lead to some damage. And if you but not to damage. If you have a decrease in kidney function over time, then ACE inhibitors can be dangerous and you have to come off for some taste changes, hypotension, especially that first dose. Contraindicated, completely contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation, ACE inhibitors and ARBs. Some ACE inhibitors can lead to a rash. It can lead to an increase in your potassium. Your next one, your ARBs, angiotensin II receptor blockers. Doesn't prevent the conversion, but it prevents the latching on, so it can't work. So you call these your ARBs or your sartans. Your ACE inhibitors are your prills. Your angiotensin II blockers are your sartans. On page 731, your table 43.1, you see angiotensin II blockers. All of them have sartan, adonisartan, ibersartan, losartan, valsartan. I want you to focus on your losartan or your Prozar. Because it blocks that conversion, it prevents that constriction, and it leaves smooth vascular muscles to relax. So it's really good for high blood pressure because that relaxing of the cardiac muscle. It's used in heart failure and for those intolerant to ACE inhibitors. That's why I call them the cousins. You have your prototype for your losartan is on the bottom of page 737. What else do you need to know on these? Oh, your next slide, your ARBs, monitoring your INO weight, side effects, monitor your potassium level, or actually can lead to an increase in potassium and can impair your renal function. Contraindicated pregnancy and lactation. Your ACE inhibitors, you do not want to take with the meal because it's going to block the absorption. Your ARBs, it doesn't matter what time you take it. It too has a first dose phenomena and orthostatic hypotension. Watching your electrolytes, especially your potassium. Let me see your ACE inhibitors. It talks about them, 734. Anything else I want you to know on them? Good in the use of diabetic neuropathy, your ACE inhibitors. Across the placenta, I talked about, contraindicated. So ACE inhibitors, ARBs, any med that is contraindicated in pregnancy, you're going to ask them if they're pregnant, ask if they're using birth control. They may want to use a secondary barrier contraceptive. You'll want to do a pregnancy test to make sure they're not pregnant before starting on these drugs. Big thing with ACE inhibitors is that cough, angioedema in the African American population. On your nursing considerations, watching volume, because anything that's going to cause a vasodilation, if you have low volume, you're going to drop in pressure. ACE inhibitors and ARBs, you both of them, you want to warn, make an alert if they're going to have surgery, because if their volume drops in surgery, they can get very hypotensive. Your ARBs, 737 starts talking about them, and all the ones end in certain. They're also oral, across the placenta, contraindicated. Hepatic renal dysfunction, you want to use extreme caution, monitor that. Watch for hyperkalemia. If they get pregnant, ACEs and ARBs have to be stopped immediately. ARBs, most common side effects are your headache, dizziness. Upper respiratory infections, they can end up with pneumonia. So you're watching for fever, some coughing, which is not due to conversion, but due to an infection. What else? Your nursing considerations, is that it can be given anytime food does not block it, but food does block the ACE inhibitors. Fetal death, so definitely not given when pregnant. Watching your potassium, watching for kidney impairment. Use extreme caution if they have some renal impairment and watch for further damage. That is it. We're going to move on into your calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers begin on page 739, also in your table. On the second page of your table, 43.1, you see your calcium channel blockers, amlodipine, diltiazem, nifedipine, verapamil. I thought this was a really good slide. Most of them end in the P, like the nifedipine and your amlodipine, which is a common one, the very nice drugs, which is your verapamil, your nifedipine, diltiazem, because verapamil and diltiazem, it's hard to remember those names. So those are calcium channel blockers. They block the calcium, which is needed for muscle contraction. So if you're blocking some of the calcium channels in the heart muscles, vascular muscles, you have less contraction, less tightness. It's going to cause those muscles to relax. So it's used to decrease that. So it decreases your constriction, decreasing your blood pressure. Calcium channel blockers will come up again when we're talking about the need for vasodilation for heart failure and when we're talking about arrhythmias because of the calcium. So right now we're talking about blood pressure, decreasing the calcium, contraindicated, it can lead to fetal toxicity, so definitely contraindicated in pregnancy, it crosses in the breast milk, contraindicated in lactation, because it blocks some of that muscle contraction and it's an antiarrhythmic, it's contraindicated if they have a heart block. Side effects, major, it can cause toxic effects on the liver, so you're watching your liver enzymes, watching for hepatic injury. Just like in any drug with the older patients, you're more chance of having side effects, adverse effects, and maybe closer monitoring, especially with the electrolytes. What else? Calcium channel blockers, 739. Decrease oxygen need, depresses myocardial contractility, GI problems, nausea, vomiting, definitely peripheral edema because of that relaxation. The higher the dose in the calcium channel blocker, especially amlodipine, you will see that. There are your, I realized when I was doing this, your next slide, I'm going to go over quickly because it's incorrect. You have focus on safety, talks about never crushing, chopping, dividing, splitting in half, any slow release or extended release, your diltiazem or cortisone, and your verapamil come in extended release or slow release forms. Drug food interaction, grapefruit juice. So. Don't worry so much. Short-acting, this says these are short-acting nifedipine and diltiazem and verapamil. So you end up having to give them like every 6 hours. So they now have diltiazem and verapamil. These two, they have a slow release and extended release. That's every 12 hours and once a day. So just don't worry about that. Just that they have those longer forms. And so you don't crush them, cut them, split them. And all calcium channel blockers, do not give with grapefruits or grapefruit juice because that leads to an increased levels or effectiveness of the calcium channel blockers and they can become toxic in those and lead to severe adverse effects. Another calcium channel blocker, an adverse effect can be skin flushing or a rash. Moving right along, anything else? We're to vasodilators, page 740. The only one I want you to focus on is your nitroprusside, which I always know as Nipride. It is always given IV, is short-term only for hypertensive crisis. Yes, you have hydralazine and minoxidil. I want you to totally focus on your Nipride or nitroprusside, which is IV, short-term for hypertensive crisis, malignant hypertension for a short time. It can lead to cyanide toxicity, so it's only given for a brief time. You have your prototype on page 743. Contraindications and contraindicated in heart failure, severe cardiac disease, pregnancy contraindicated unless you have your benefit outweighs your risk. Otherwise, contraindicated, and definitely contraindicated in breastfeeding because it crosses over and can hurt the fetus, the neonate. Adverse effects, extreme drop in your blood pressure, headache. You can get a reflex tachycardia. That's because your blood pressure drops so rapidly, so low, that your heart rate increases in response to try to increase your blood flow. You can have a skin rash, abnormal hair growth, cyanide toxicity, which is dyspnea, headache, vomiting, which you would check your blood levels. What else? Really, let's see. Vasodilators, I'm looking at your nursing considerations. Watch with caution if impaired kidney or liver. Definitely try to avoid it in pregnancy unless the benefit outweighs the risk. Monitoring for severe hypotension, GI distress, signs of skin reaction or the cyanide poisoning. Watching your electrolytes. And let's see, anything else, disease, headache. You can actually have some anxiety. Oh, I didn't mention here, diuretics, page 744. There's just a little section, you don't even have to look at it. Talks about adding diuretics for antihypertensives. What I want you to remember is your HCTZ or hydrochlorothiazide. We will talk again about hydrochlorothiazide when we get to diuretics, but it is can be used according to the studies as it's very mild diuretic and used as your first line for your blood pressure management. Sometimes by itself, it is very more effective in the African American population, and then it's used in combination with multiple antihypertensives. I'm not asking you on this test. I just want you to be familiar because it can show up on NCLEX or Kaplan. Box 43-4 on page 730. It shows all these combination drugs for hypertension. You'll see ACE inhibitors combined with calcium channel blockers or ARBs with calcium channel blockers, all of them beta blockers or with ARBs. The only combination you will not see that you never put together, you never put an ACE inhibitor with an ARB or angiotensin retention blocker. Okay, keep moving. We're going to go into the next chapter 44. I want you to start at page 755. You see cardiotonic agents. We're starting with cardiac glycosides. The one you need to know is digoxin or linoxin. It increases positive inotrope. That means it squeezes, causes the heart to have a stronger contraction. It works with your sodium, potassium, if you remember way back with your Krebs cycle on your AMP. So it impacts that calcium level that's in the heart muscle, so the contraction is stronger, slower. So digoxin does a few things when it increases the contraction, so it's used for heart failure. It also slows down the heart rate because the squeeze is better, and all of this leads to better pump, which improves kidney function and leads to a diuresis and taking some edema away is like their side effects. Interestingly, your digoxin or linoxin is released unchanged, completely unchanged in the urine. What does that mean to you? That means it's excreted in the urine. If your kidney function is impaired at all, that because it's excreted unchanged, if it's not excreted because you have a renal impairment, you have retain that and you will get ditch toxic. And there's not a lot of room with your digoxin. Your little thing here, toxic level right in the middle. Digoxin is toxic above 2.0. Your therapeutic is 0.5 to 2.0. So you have a very narrow range of effectiveness, very high risk for toxicity. Ditch toxic will show as confusion, big deal. Confusion, abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting are the biggies. You'll see abnormal heart rates or decreased heart rates. Here with this potassium, this is the heart, it's not pumping real well, there's not the potassium and calcium are not functioning well, so very little pump. You give him a digoxin, it's therapeutics, a nice strong contraction. You start toxic and your rhythm is all over the place, and if it continues and you'll not be able to contract and you'll get into almost a systole here, it can lead to death. Big deal to watch for ditch toxicity. Let me see, page 756, I'm looking, I talked about that there. Low margin of safety, it's given orally or parenterally IV, so it's oral or IV, excreted on change in the urine. Contraindicated with heart blocks, acute heart attack, very, very cautiously in pregnancy and lactation. So you only give it if the benefit outweighs the risk. Of course, very careful with geriatrics because they usually have a decreased clearance in their kidneys, so you're using lower doses and being very careful. A big side effect is that yellow halo, the vision changes that they can report, and arrhythmias. It has this whole section, box 44.6 or 44.4 on the bottom of 757, watching your renal function, being very, very careful. The thing with digoxin, no matter what age, you always check an apical pulse for a full minute or 60 seconds. You never give digoxin without doing an apical, no other pulse, but an apical pulse rate for a minimum of 60 seconds. You time it for the full minute. Do not give it if your heart rate is 60 or is below 60. Sometimes they will actually write an order for a higher thing, but if you don't have a written order for when to hold it, you hold it for under 60. You'll see on page 758, box 445. Digoxin immune fab is what you give if your dig talk hits, your dig level is greater than 10. They give digoxin immune fab to pull out the digoxin to reverse it. Because dig toxicity is life threatening, often you will have an elevated potassium of 5 or higher when you're dig toxic 2. Drug drug interactions. Increased therapeutic effects if taken with verapamil, which is a calcium channel blocker. Remember the very nice drugs. Increased risk of cardiac arrhythmias if taken with potassium losing diuretics, such as your thiazide, more so with your loop diuretics like furosemide. That's because you're losing potassium. If your potassium is low, you're more at risk for dig toxicity. Dig is less effective if taken with thyroid hormones. In that whole section, critical thinking scenario, just over on the right-hand side, evaluation, it talks about that yellow halo. Do you have upset, drowsiness, you know, you're looking for dig toxicity. On page 760, a little more there, decreased absorption with cholestyramine, which we will talk about later, or cholestipol. Both of those are anti-lipids that block certain absorptions of all your fat-soluble vitamins and blocks your digoxin absorption. Also antacids. Always want to take your digoxin around the same time every day. If you're going to give the... What else? Oh, interactions. There we go. Box 44.6 talks about herb interaction with this. I found this picture might be a little busy for you. Licorice actually can increase hypertension, but your things that increase your dig level... I found one thing that talked about, no, is this it? Make sure I don't get this wrong, I'm getting tired. Yes, I am going to get it wrong. Okay, so you're going to be cautious, increase dig levels with taking licorice, ginseng, Verapamil, which is a calcium channel blocker, so just remember those there. And St. John's wort decreases your DIG levels. So we're going to move on to page 762. You see your phosphodiesterase inhibitors. The only one you need to know is your Milrinona Primacort. Actually, it's the only one there is. You have a prototype on page 763. This is to make your heart pump stronger. It is only given IV. It's given mics per kilogram per minute. It is given short term just for acute congestive heart failure to pull them out of it. Preferred drug for treating congestive heart failure episodes in patients that are already taking beta blockers. I said short-term use IV only increases calcium level in the cell to make that contraction stronger. Anything else you need to know? I'm looking here. Caution with excretion in the elderly, like you would with anything with the elderly. And I think that is really it. That's all you need to know on this one. Okay, drugs affecting cardiac action potential. But these are your antiarrhythmics, which is chapter 45. I want you to go right to page 774. Don't worry about all those strips there. We're going to break this down. Box 45.1, we're going to look at the second box down, class 1B, your lidocaine, class 2 antiarrhythmic, the third one, propranolol or Inderol, which is one of your beta blockers. Flip the page onto your class 4. You have your diltiazem and verapamil. Remember, your very nice drugs or your calcium channel blockers. That can block that calcium, and of course arrhythmias. And then your other antiarrhythmics focus on your digoxin or linoxin, which we just talked about. So first we'll talk a little bit about your lidocaine, which can be given for your heart. It is given IV only. It crosses the placenta, so it is contraindicated. I know this lidocaine can be given IM. It says I have never seen it IM. I've only seen it IV, but it does say it can be given IM. It crosses the placenta, so it's contraindicated in pregnancy, unless you absolutely have to, if the benefit outweighs the risk. But does enter the breast milk, so it's completely contraindicated in lactation. Contraindicated if they have a bradycardia, severe hypotension, heart failure, or a heart block. Monitoring for, and it can be given a bolus or a continuous drip. You're looking for central nervous system symptoms or problems. Dizziness, lightheadedness, watch for nausea, vomiting. You have your prototype on the top of page 778. Avoid foods, food drug interaction. Oh, no, skip that there. That's not for lidocaine. I don't need you to go there. Anything else? That is it for that. Move on to your next one, which is your beta adrenergic blockers, or what we refer to as your beta blockers. Focus on your propranolol or Inderol. As you remember, with your beta blockers, hypotension, symptoms of congestive heart failure, bradycardia, drowsiness. Also, it can lead to insomnia and vivid dreams. You can have a lot of GI issues and hypotension. Propranolol 779, you have a prototype there. Vivid dreams, insomnia, fatigue, GI upset. What else do I want you to know? we've covered beta blockers before, and so we're going to keep moving here. Move right on out of... Wait a minute. Where's my calcium channel blockers? Did I do that? Back up. Going back to this slide, you see your class 4. I mentioned your calcium channel blockers, your verapamil and diltiazem, which we've talked before, but it is in your table, just remembering that they're also antiarrhythmics because they're blocking the calcium and the irritation there. So both of those are used for this. I just wonder, not sure if I said that, I'm just getting tired. Okay, now move along into chapter 46. Start at page, the bottom of 789 mentions nine traits. Just flip the page on over to 790, table 46.1. You see your first section with your nitrates. Don't worry about amyl nitrate. It was those little capsules that used to pop under your nose if you passed out, but people were getting high with them, so you don't find those anymore. Isobide, you may see around. It's an oral long-acting nitrate that some people are on chronically for certain anginas, but what we will focus on today only for this exam is your nitroglycerins, which come in a million forms. It causes vasodilation, so that's why it's used for angina. Unfortunately, one of the major side effects, because it dilates and it's not picky, it dilates the vessels everywhere, so it dilates the vessels in your head and leads to a tremendous headache. Here again, you'll see calcium channel blockers used for angina because of both the vasodilation effect and calming down the heart rhythm. And then you see your beta blockers popping up here again. You'll see it on table 46.1, metoprolol and Unalol. Anything that olol, or focus on metoprolol for the purposes of this unit and this exam. You see your calcium channel blockers there again here on your table 46.1, and all three of them here are your very nice drugs, all three listed there. We're going to go into your nitrates. It comes in a million forms, as you can see here on page 792. Focus on safe administration. It discusses the different ones. You have your prototype in 793. Easier if you flip over best section to see this is in your critical thinking scenario, all the way over on page 797, first column of that thing, the sublingual nitroglycerin, usually relieves chest pain within 3 to 5 minutes. You take one every 5 minutes until you reach the third tablet. If you've taken 3 tablets, you need to call an ambulance or get to the hospital if you've not had complete relief. You're teaching your nitroglycerin tablets, or all nitroglycerin is sensitive to the light. That's why it's in a dark bottle, also sensitive to heat, so not stored in a warm area. Like when I lived in Florida, people used to put their little nitro bottles in their glove box so they'd have it handy, but then it would be ineffective because the heat would destroy the effectiveness. And they never use the whole bottle. They usually expire before then. You teach them to pop one under their tongue. If they're not getting a little tingle under the tongue, or the tingle is barely there, they need to get a new bottle, because it should have a little tingle. There's patches, there's ointments. Do not get that nitro on your hand. Tell them not to, because it'll cause that horrible, horrible headache. You rotate your sites for that. Nitroglycerin can be given IV in a continuous drip. If it's the oral, the slow release, the isobide, which we're not worrying about today, but you do not crush it because it's a slow release, like any slow release drug. What else do I need you to know? some contraindications. Don't worry about these. Your nitrates just contraindicated with aortic stenosis. Let's see. Your beta blockers you know about, your metoprolol, your maldol, olols. Caution with diabetes, which you should remember right now because of masking the hypo or hypoglycemic symptoms. Caution with peripheral vascular disease and with asthma, COPD, any pulmonary restrictive disease. Beta blockers, dizziness. Oh, big thing on your beta blockers, because it's blocking those beta cells, they will complain of a decreased exercise tolerance and malaise. That's a very, very common complaint. They can have bronchospasm, dyspnea, but decreased exercise tolerance. And interaction between the beta blocker and clonidine causing a rebound hypertension. Okay, so if you're so close, just keep going. A few more chapters to follow. This is where I split the lecture in half to give you a little breather because it got too long. And I sure hope when I open this thing up that this thing is recorded. Diltiazem, calcium channel blockers, the very nice drugs are at the end of this chapter, which we've covered and covered and covered. And we're going to get into chapter 47, the beginning of the next part of this lecture, which are lipid-lowering agents.